स्टार्ट करो।
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, आई प्रीतम बंदोपाध्याय फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश हल्दिया गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस नेशनल वेबिनार बीइंग ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश हल्दिया गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज माय डिपार्टमेंट इन कोलैबोरेशन विद द IQAC ऑफ द सेम कॉलेज दैट इज हल्दिया गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज एंड द वेबिनार इज ऑन सुकुमार राय द उवरे एंड द ट्रांसलेशंस. This webinar is being held on the Google Meet platform, where unfortunately today only the speakers and the organizers will be present. For the rest, it is being streamed live on YouTube. We could not avoid this arrangement because of the limited capacity of Google Meet. You all know there's a huge number of participants interested in this program. And we could not actually discriminate among them, and so we chose to stream the program live on YouTube for everyone, just apart from the organizers and the speakers. And this huge number of people I know is listening in now, and this group, huge group, includes our students, colleagues, students from other institutions, teachers from other colleges and universities, and also guests from other walks of life. I want to begin by saying that we are really grateful to each and every one of you for being with us today. Although a colleague of mine is officially entrusted with the responsibility of offering the vote of thanks officially at the end of the program, may I at the very beginning thank each and every one associated with this event for making it possible. We are proud to have with us the two esteemed speakers, Dr. Shourabh Dash Thakur and Sri Rindan Kundu, with us. Truly, we are indebted to them for finding time for us from their busy schedule today. A very hearty welcome to both of you. It's an honor to have with us our respected officer in charge, Dr. Pijush Kanti Tripathi, today, without whose active tutelage and inspiration, this program would not have been possible. His support, his encouragement is always with us. Welcome, sir, to this webinar. The other reassuring presence is that of the IQAC coordinator, Dr. Dipankar Sadhukha, more a friend than a colleague. He's an assistant professor from the mathematics department, who also happens to be the co-organizer of this event. Without his constant support, once again, this would not have been possible. I welcome you to this webinar, Dr. Shahid Khan. Two other names must be mentioned, although I can see that they have preferred to keep themselves invisible. Yet, it is because of them that, you know, we are visible to one another today. It is because of them that this program can be held. They are Dr. Debolina Dash and Professor Tonmoy Maiti, the two indispensable members of the technical support team of our college. Thank you, both of you, and welcome to the program. We also have with us here the other members of the organizing committee, my departmental colleagues, Dr. Srimanto Dash, Sri Ayushman Banerjee, Mohammad Moniruddin Sheikh, although I think he has not yet joined, but he'll be joining very soon, and Sri Shomokanti Ghosh. Shomo Babu has also not yet joined, but we are waiting for him. I hope he'll join very soon. I shall now call upon our officer in charge, Dr. Tripathi, to kindly say a few words by way of officially inaugurating the webinar. Dr. Tripathi, please. Please unmute yourself, sir.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Okay. Very good afternoon, on the first set, I convey my sincere gratitude and thanks.
You are not visible, sir. Would you please switch on the camera?
Yes, now both I am audible and visible. Visible and audible. So, very good afternoon. Today, I like to convey my sincere thanks and gratitude to the Department of English of our college for organizing such fantastic national webinar on Sukumar Roy, the oeuvre and the translations. And I really feel proud to welcome the two eminent speakers and distinguished persons, Dr. Saurabh Das Thakur from Vishwabharati University and Rindon Kundu from Sri Sri University. We are really fortunate to have them with us. Despite their busy schedule, they have given their consent to share their experiences with us. So I welcome on behalf of the Institute as well as the department and as well as me also, I welcome them. I also welcome all the participants and both participants for attending this national webinar, because without whom this webinar cannot be a success. So I welcome them. I also extend my thanks to our IQAC coordinator, Dr. Sadhu Khan. I welcome him, and I also thank to the technical advisors without whose help the webinar cannot successfully organize. So though I am not the field of the literature, but Sukumar Roy is very familiar to each and everyone. And being a Bengali, I must proud of that. Sukumar Roy, famous Bengali writer, because he mainly remembered for the work of children. He was the son of Upendra Kishore Roy. And when he born in such an era, actually the time was known as the Bengal Renaissance. And I know that Upendra Kishore Roy, he was directly the friend of Rabindranath Tagore, and also the family friend of Jagadish Chandra Bose and Prafulla Chandra Roy. So Rabindranath Tagore influenced the literary activities of Sukumar Roy directly, and he also his work, because work of Sukumar Roy also influenced by the Prafulla Chandra Roy and Jagadish Chandra Bose. So blended both the literature as well as the science. And we know that Sukumar Roy graduated, I think so, if I'm not wrong, graduated both in physics and chemistry, that means the science discipline. And he's a versatile genius, because he also got a distinct degree in printing technology also. However, Sukumar Roy had an amazing sense of humor and sharp power of observation, unfathomed marched with profound comment of assembling the words that produced a class of humor which was equally praised and accepted by the children as well as the grown-up. So his work like Kumbh Potas and or the Abul Tabul. So we all really enjoy it most. So from this today's webinar, we will be enjoying, we will be knowing about the different aspects of Sukumar Roy from our eminent speakers. And I hope, like me, all will be equally benefited by listening and also sharing our experiences and views also. So I extend my heartfelt thanks and congratulations to all of you who have participated in this national waiver. I again congratulate to the organizers, as well as that I tender my respect to this today's two eminent speakers, Dr. Sourabh Das Thakur and Rindon Kundu. Hope we really be benefited from this seminar. Thank you to all.
Thank you, Pijush Babu, for your words. Your words have really enriched us today at the very beginning. I'd also now like to request the IQAC coordinator of our college, Dr. Dipankar Sadhuka, to say a few words. Dipankar, please.
Good afternoon to all. On behalf of the IQAC Haldia Government College, first of all, I would like to welcome today's eminent speaker, Dr. Sourabh Das Thakur, Associate Professor from Vishwa Bharati, and Mr. Rindon Kundu, Assistant Professor in Department of English, CC University. Now, I like to thank our officer in charge, Dr. Pijush Kanti Tripathi, for his continuous support and encouragement for any kind of educational activity for the college, and also Professor Tanmoy Kumar Maiti and Dr. Devolian Adar for their technical support for this kind of webinar. Already, this is the third webinar of our college, and both of them work very hard, especially for the first one. And now, regular basis, they are working with this technical activity. Also, I would like to thank Mr. Pritam Bandyopadhyay, HOD, English Department, along with the other members, Dr. Simanta Das, Mr. Ayushman Banerjee, Mohammad Moniruddin Sheikh, Mr. Somokanti Ghosh, for organizing this webinar, and especially the topic they choose, Sukumar Rao, the Obra, and the translation. Actually, the technical term, the translation and other thing, we are not experts, so we are not in a position to say too much about that. But as a Bengali, we can say that every Bengali starts to listen to Sukumar Rao's Awol Tawol even before we learn to speak. His work like Pagla Dasu, Haja Borala, Awol Tawol are assets for Bengali childhood. In my personal view, the characters like Kumru Patas, Hukumu Kahengla, Hasjaru, and many more created by Mr. Roy in his short lifespan, actually the concept of cultivation of new creatures in animal kingdom. Okay, however, so today we love to hear about Sukumar Rao's work from our invited speakers. And with this, we thank you everybody, and let's start the session with Professor Sourabh Das Thakur. Please, welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Sadhuka. So, with our officer in charge, Dr. Tripathi's permission, we shall now begin the webinar proper. Sukumar Rao is an author very close to our hearts. He lives with us through his delightful poetry and prose, much of which is usually categorized as nonsense literature. His multi-layered portrayals, the satire lurking behind his apparently innocuous fantasy. His singular and strange oeuvre is a must-read for children, yet most of us will agree that it is not children's literature, or at least it is not merely children's literature. Today, I feel exceptionally privileged to present before you our first speaker, Dr. Sourabh Das Thakur. It's a privilege even to introduce him. Dr. Sourabh Das Thakur is Associate Professor of English at Vishwa Bharati. His areas of research include children's literature, modernist literature, culture studies, and translation. He has published academic articles in books and journals of national and international repute, including the Journal of Asian Studies, and also co-guest edited a special issue of Sangeet Natak, the Journal of Sangeet Natak Academy, New Delhi, on Rabindranath Tagore. He is also the joint editor of the book Timeless Tales from Bengal, an anthology of Bangla children's and young adults' stories. His translations of poetry, short fiction, and non-fiction pieces between English and Bangla have been published in several books and journals. As we all know today, the title of his presentation is Nonsense, Nationhood, and Bengali Modernity, Notes Towards Reading Abol Tabol. Over to Dr. Dash Thakur.
Am I properly visible, Pritamda?
Yes, almost. If you could, yes, it's much better now.
Is it all right now?
It's fine.
Thank you, Pritamda, for inviting me to speak in this webinar. Particularly because, as you know, I am from Medinipur. So there's a particular emotional attachment with this district in my heart. So it's a kind of homecoming of sorts. I cannot visit my birthplace, my native place, because of obvious circumstances right now. But it's a kind of virtual homecoming for me. So thank you, Pritamda, Professor Tripathi, and the other organizers of this webinar. Today I shall talk about Abol Tabol primarily, but at the same point of time, let me make it clear at the very outset that that after the wonderful work done by several generations of critics, especially Shivaji Bandyopadhyay, whose remarkable book on Bangla children's literature, Gopal Rakhal Dondo Samash, you probably all are familiar with, it's very difficult to say anything new really on Sukumar Rai. And yet I feel that I believe that each presentation should carry in it something new. So what I do today, what I plan to do today is to, yes, talk about Abol Tabol, but at the same point of time, use Abol Tabol as a prism, as an occasion, to talk about Sukumar Rai at large, and not only Sukumar Rai, as far as possible to talk about several other producers of children's literature at the turn of the century, contemporary to Sukumar Rai. And maybe I'll also kind of invest a lot of time on the contemporary discursive context within which we must locate Sukumar Rai, without knowing which probably our appreciation of not only Abol Tabol, but Sukumar Rai's entire corpus, even the contemporary children's literature, world of children's literature, would be somewhat incomplete. So, while talking about this discursive context at the turn of the 20th century, I will focus on certain aspects, obviously, as we all know. It's the twilight period of the very rich. Bengal Renaissance. So it's 20th century. Obviously, I must limit myself. I kind of choose for my particular focus a few aspects of certain problems in the dominant discourse of Bengal Renaissance, which was operative behind the creation of our own history. Because we are all products of the Bengal Renaissance in one sense or the other. It is the history of our identity. Bengal Renaissance at one level is the bedrock of the modern Bengali subjectivity. So this moment of colonial modernity and modernity's transaction with tradition, or what we might alternatively refer to as a kind of transaction between indigenism on the one hand and Westernism on the other, is at the root of the history of modern Bengali subjectivity. So I'll talk about this history of modern Bengali subjectivity and use that as a discursive context to locate Sukumar Rai at large and Abol Tabol in particular, and thus try and understand certain loopholes, certain lacunas in the history of our own making, in the history of the making of the 20th century modern Bengali individual. And I argue that Abol Tabol is a wonderful work, fascinating, multi-layered work, which gives us beautiful glimpses of his strengths and lacunas of the modern Bengali subjectivity. In my presentation, I will focus on the iconic Bangla children's favorite Abol Tabol, Rhymes Without Reason. But the observations and readings offered here, to my mind, would also apply not just to other collections of Ray's poems, notably Khai Khai, Ever Hungry, but also to certain other works of Bangla children's literature produced in the late 19th, early 20th century, colonial Bengal. Much of the work of children's literature produced by the likes of Rabindranath Tagore, Dakshinaranjan Mitra Majumdar, and Upendra Kishore Raichaudhuri in the early 20th century, and by Sukumar Rai himself in other genres like prose and drama, in my reading, are amenable to the kind of argument I am going to offer in the present paper. In that sense, my objective here is to submit a brief reading of certain aspects of Bangla children's literature in the late colonial Bengal to the prism of Abul Thapur, for which I shall claim a certain representative status. This, in turn, may also help us understand the literary ramifications of certain contradictions in the emergent Bengali modernity and the Kolkata Bhadrolok subjectivity centered to the genre of early Bengali children's literature in particular and the project of the so-called Bengal Renaissance in general. The early Bengali children's literature drew profusely on its European, especially English counterpart, as many other literary and cultural genres and fields did in the 19th century. The novel form, nature-centric romantic poetry, public theatre are only a few examples of the cultural transactions that were taking place between Britain and India, Bengal in particular, in the second half of the 19th century and after. Children's literature as a genre started to grow in the mother country, that is England, during the Romantic movement in the late 18th, early 19th century, with a growing nationalist consciousness in that part of the world acting as a discursive backdrop. This is also the time when the British city middle class would revisit the ancient British past in search of the roots of an authentic British national culture, an impulse that would on the one hand give a fillip to the romantic engagement with the folk and the popular, and on the other hand, stimulate the practice of creating modern children's literature through rereading and recirculation of poems like folktale and fable. My point here is that the birth and early growth of the genre of children's literature in Britain in the early 19th century was essentially implicated in the process of cultivation of a national and nationalist imagination. No wonder then that the genre would receive an unprecedented impetus and reach its zenith in the late 19th century Victorian period in England, the time of culmination of the British nationalist pride at home and imperial prowess in the world. Without claiming any derivative ideological status for the history of growth and development of Bengali children's literature, more or less a century later, in the late 19th, early 20th century, one cannot but notice the parallels between the two traditions. Brainchild of the emergent city upper caste middle class, the Bhadrolok, fought in the challenges of nation building to a reconciliation of indigenism and westernism and of tradition and modernity. Bengali children's literature emerged as an interesting site for several ideological tussles and experimentations, which were central to the formation of the modern Bengali or even Indian subjectivity. The so-called Bengal Renaissance of the 19th century no doubt created the discursive space for challenging a host of traditional hierarchies in various spheres of life and thus ushering in modernity in a particular sense. But at the same time, it brought new forms of center-margin dyads, new fissures and ruptures absent in the pre-colonial Bengali culture. For only a couple of instances, one can invoke the urban, rural, Bhadrolok, Chotolok, traditional woman, new woman dyads and the like. The new notions of good taste, morality and aesthetics introduced by English education in the colonial capital of Calcutta resulted in a new reality of cultural hegemony, where Calcutta emerged as the undisputed center of Bengali culture and the emergent modern Bengali subjectivity, and the minority Bhadrolok community residing in the metropolis as the locus of that culture. The historian Sumanta Banerjee writes, I quote from Sumanta Banerjee's Parlor and the Streets, the Bengali elite in the late 19th century demonstrated a certain sense of continuity in shaping a distinct literature of its own, an indigenous school of music, and a taste in fine arts. By the 1870s, the cultural forms of expression of the Bengali Bhadroloks had developed a stylistic unity, which resulted from the patronage of a social group that had become economically, culturally, and politically unified. The urban middle class, which the elite culture represented, reconstituted the lines of deference, patronage, and moral authority in Calcutta society by distancing itself from and suppressing later on, the old popular culture of the lower orders. Let me produce only a small sample of the suicidal haughtiness, self-centrism, and exclusivism of the Calcutta Bhadrlok elite, published in 1928, 5 years after Abul Tawul hit the stands. This is from the editorial column of the first number of the newly revived Shonibare Chitti, one of the major periodicals of the time. I quote from this editorial column of Shonibare Chitti, Bangladesh's Shatkara in Bengal. বাংলাদেশের শতকরা 99 জনের কাছে অপঠিত থাকিয়াই যদি রবীন্দ্রনাথের যুগ চলিয়া যায়, রবীন্দ্রনাথ শরৎচন্দ্রের জীবিতাবস্থাটি যদি নজরুল ইসলাম সাহিত্যে যুগাবতার বলিয়া ঘোষিত হন, তাহা হইলে সমাপ্তি হোক এই সাহিত্যে, এই বটতলার দেশে সাহিত্য চলিবে না, ইহা জানিয়া আমরা নিশ্চিত থাকি। রিমেম্বার দ্যাট দিস ইজ 1928। রিয়েল লিটারেচার অ্যাকর্ডিং টু দিস ডিকটাম ওয়াজ অ্যাবাউট দি টেস্ট অ্যান্ড কালচার অফ দি মিনিস্কিউল বাট হেজিমনিক 1% মাইনরিটি and had no place for the life and practice of the rest 99% of the population who are derisively described as the inhabitants of what call our Desh in it. Clearly, two or even more nations were already emerging within one as an aftermath of colonial modernity, the political and cultural price of which Bengal and India would have to pay ever since, even today in our own times. Rabindranath Tagore once wrote of Sukumar Rai in the introduction to Ray's first anthology of schoolboy stories, Bagladashu, published posthumously in 1940, I quote from Tagore. He had the gravity of a scientific temperament in his nature, and that's why he would so playfully demonstrate its contradictions. Unquote. This self-critical scientific temperament and the essentially urban sophistication in its manifestations in the literary discourses was confined to the enlightened Calcutta Bhadrlok minority in the early 20th century colonial Bengal. Ray's own notion of literature per se as a product of the city-bred, English-educated, cultured mind is recorded in his essay, Kabole Patro, Sukumata, where he is somewhat dismissive of the idea of Polli Sahitya. The elitist Arnoldian inflection in this notion of ethnic self-fashion is instructive. Yet, his so-called nonsense literature, relentlessly mocks, lampoons, satirizes, and thus exposes the inner fissures and paradoxes of the same hegemonic minority, Bhadrlok project of modernity from within. In my reading, Abul Tawul can act as a wonderful prism through which we can expose some of these inconsistencies in the contemporary Bhadrlok practice of colonial modernity. While the poems in the collection, as Shivaji Bandyopadhyay has already so admirably shown in his groundbreaking Gopal Rakhal Dandoshamas, offer glimpses of this modernity in the form of resistance to various power structures, I would argue that the poems themselves are not completely free of such operations of power as they put up for censor. Ray's rhymes, after all, are products of the cultural critics from within and quite inevitably, probably unwittingly, ends up bolstered. The Bengali colonial modernity has been thus, to borrow a phrase from Jürgen Habermas, an incomplete project, rife with promises and pitfalls in no unequal measure. The history of the Bengali middle class Bhadrlok culture from the early 19th century to the early 20th was a history of tumultuous discursive journey, a period of groping for directions towards individual, ethnic, and national self-fashioning through fiercely fought ideational battles. It was also the time of Bengals, or at least these Bhadrloks, movement from an exclusively feudal culture to a predominantly capitalist culture, all within a span of 70, 80 years. Needless to say, it had to be a culture of excesses too. From the early 19th century young Bengal radical excess to the reactionary Hindu revivalist excess in the 1870s and 80s, from the mid 19th century Babu excess to the mid and late 19th century Brahmo puritanical excess, the Swadeshi nationalist excess in the past decade of the 20th century, from the somewhat ludicrous excess of sobriquets in the late 19th century, a time abounding in your Maharshis, Shamijis, Paramahamsas, Brahmabandhavs, Brahmanathas, Vidyasagars, Banglar Bugs, and little later Netajis and Gurudevs, and so on, to arbitrarily mention only a few, to the grave idealistic excess in the past few decades of the 20th century, the time offered a plentiful to be perceptive viewer and listener. To use another postmodern concept slightly anachronistically, it was a vibrant world governed by a plethora of visual and auditory images. Such images, of course, were up for various sorts of criticism by a few rationally grounded and detached minds of the time, themselves part of this Bhadrlok culture, though of the likes of Uttam, Parashuram, and Tagore, who relentlessly chastised such excesses through brilliant use of wit and humor. None did that, of course, in the world of children's literature. One can thus locate Sukumar Rai in this Bengali tradition of modern, urban, scientific, chiseled humor centered on the emergent Bhadra public space, and yet see his uniqueness where he is favored by the adult and the juvenile in the same measure. The poems in Abu Dhabi really capture the fascinating visual and oral world, almost narcissistically in love with its own excesses. They do that primarily through terse, intuitive, and evocative character sketches of apparently out of this world fantastic individuals who are a little exaggerated and seriocomically presented versions of people crowding a culture in transition. They're essentially poems of the newly emerging colonial public sphere, the eccentric timber technologist in Kathguru, the officers in Gompchuri and Chotwara, the innovator in Kudorpol, the shadow catcher in Chhayabaji, the impractical bookworm in Timushki, the doctor in Hathure, characters from various other walks of life, including the policeman, fortune teller, singer, bodybuilder, warrior, teacher, pseudoscientist, knowledge seeker, and even the jobless, benevolent, and moral advisor, represent an urban middle-class world of increasing opportunities and expanding aspirations. The illustrations accompanying the poems also tell us as much. Yet, one cannot but note in dismay the absence of any active female figure as such in this joyous carnival of characters out in the open. Only three women play any substantial role in this collection of 45 rhymes. But even the old woman in Gudirbadi is too preoccupied with a crumbling shelter, the affectionate ghost mother in Kutude Khala too phantasmal, and the present in absence bride in Shokpa too obscure to step out into the world of growing hopes and opportunities to seek out rooms of their own. There are, of course, honorable mentions of the royal aunt and queen in Gomba Gaur Raja, and a passing reference to Keshtodasha Pishi in Kathu Kutuguru. The Pishi being a vegetable vendor and thus the only woman active in the public sphere in the entire collection. In fact, the tattered old lady in Gudirbadi is the only female character present in Flesh and Blood. The rhymes, in short, center around the well-known beneficiaries of the colonial rule and the so-called Bengal Renaissance, a privileged minority, namely the urban, middle-class, mostly educated, upper-caste Hindu men, the Bhadras. Yet another excess, indeed, but not too far away from the mark, if one thinks of faithful representation of the contemporary culture, Calcutta culture. Children, or more precisely the adolescent, are central to the body. As they're in almost all of Ray's poetry, prose and drama, the portrayal of such early teen children at one level undoubtedly mark an advance from the earlier tradition of their representation in Bengali children's literature, where, more often than not, they are merely instruments of imparting certain lessons to the target readers. The early growth of children's literature in both Britain and Bengal, as we have briefly noted, were implicated in the aesthetics and politics of nation building. Family thus was imagined in both traditions as the microcosm of the nation, with specific role assigned to each of its segments. Discourses of ideal family, domesticity, parenthood, child rearing abounded in literary works, manuals, and pamphlets in both cultures at this time. Throughout the late 19th and early 20th centuries, middle-class ideologues, reformers, and nationalists in Calcutta produced a rich body of diverse literature that often acted as repositories of the new vision of a reformed family, an ideal woman, and a perfect child, all leading to the idea of the perfect nation. Abul Tabul, at one level, certainly succeeds in getting rid of such normative discursive engagements. And yet, a slightly keener observation yields us a glimpse of a different order of normativity in this collection. Such normativity, when historicized, can help us locate the uneven and polyphonic nature not only of the literary discourse, but also of the contradictions in the culture which produces them. These children in Abul Tabul, as well as most of his other creations, as presented in the poems and portrayed in the accompanying illustrations, are boys without a single exception. This becomes particularly disturbing when one considers the fact that most of Ray's poems were first published in Songdesh, the magazine for the juvenile people, which, as Ray was well aware, catered to both boys and girls. In fact, the cover design of the first issue of Songdesh, which came out in Bangla Tarushukuri, May 1913, featured a brother and a sister poring over their copy of the magazine. But ironically, neither the photoscope banding pseudoscientist, nor the victim in Vigyan Shikha, neither the old Tickle My Ribs, nor his prey in Kathukutuguru, neither the doctor, nor his patient in Hathure, and neither the storyteller, nor the hapless listener in Golpo Bola is a girl or a woman. The genderless real world of storytelling outside, in which the poems participate, as the first cover design could attest, is thus shattered by a gendered world of storytelling within it. The poem's question norms in the existing system, but in turn create and strengthen equally consistent, homogeneous structures. In fact, there are very few girls or other female figures present in Ray's entire corpus, or in Rabindranath's works for children, or for that matter, Satyajit Ray's narratives for the young adult. Probably none of Dakshinaranjan Mitra Majumdar's collected folk tales in Thakur Marjuli, or Abhinindranath's modern fairy tales is told from perspective of female figure, like a girl or a woman. The very few girls dotting over Ray's canvas are represented as belonging to sharply divided moral categories, like good and bad, as opposed to the carefree naughty boys in Tantri Chele, Kakukutu Guru, Bujiye Bola, and the like. Out of Ray's 7 published dramas and a playlet, 5 were plays of high ideas meant for the adult, and a significantly without quit an exclusively male dramatist person, and only one Hinshuti with the moral vice of envy as its theme makes room for girls as characters. In other words, the earlier tradition of moralization and didacticism in children's literature makes an unceremonious return to Ray's universe and thereby dilutes his spirit of whimsy or khayal rosh the moment the other sex makes its entry in his corpus. In contrast, one cannot imagine the world of Ray bereft of Pagla Dashu and his gang and innumerable other adventurous boys exploring and savoring a nascent public sphere with fun and frolic. Indeed, at times they suffer, but that's only a part of the game, a small price to pay for the masculine adventurous abandon that also spices things up a bit, and at any rate, much preferable to being non-existent or remaining confined to the safety of four walls, like the angels in the house. Ray's nonsensical world, with apparently no rhyme or reason, thus builds a uniform and consistent discourse of masculinity and femininity. And yet, it seems, it catches them pretty young too, to instill in them the desirable values in the era of modern Bengali popular self-fashion. The dissociation of signifiers from the socio-culturally and linguistically accepted signifiers and the reassociation to new permutations and combinations lead to the creation of an apparently nonsensical world. This paves the way for the discovery and reconstruction of unconventional possibilities embedded in the universe around the region. The generic nomenclature nonsense thus becomes suspect, the texts now becoming a repository of alternative senses or significations. Although Ray himself claimed in his preface to Abul Tawun that the book dealt with the strange, the peculiar, and the impossible, and thus it amounted to a book of whimsy, Jibonanonda Das, somebody who one would not usually associate with the world of nonsense or the comic or the humorous, the ultimate serious quote in Bengal, Jibonanonda Das wrote to the publisher Dilip Kumar Gupta about Sukumar Rai. I quote from Jibonanonda Das: "It seems there exist many more worlds within the world of ours. It's not that one can see them with these or her physical eyes. There they are in the creative minds of those that show us. What is true in the world of Sukumar is Abul Tawun, though not as true as the known world around us or its reflections, is equally familiar and real." Even whimsy, therefore, is embedded in the available discursive milieu, and it reproduces in work of art, albeit in an oblique and inverse fashion, the reality around. Even the unconscious and its representation are not radically autonomous entities, because they are linguistically mediated and thus only reorder the familiar in literature instead of bypassing reality altogether. Sukumar Rai, born in 1887, grew up at the time of the development of the Indian anti-colonial nationalist consciousness and raging debates on various socio-cultural issues within the nationalist world. While the early and mid-1950s social reform movements under the leadership of the likes of Raja Ram Mohan Rai and Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar prioritized the woman question, the era of self-criticism gave way around this time, that is around Ray's time, to a new set of ideological constructs that domesticated this problem in a convenient resolution. Parthu Chatterjee refers to this phase of Hindu cultural nationalism as one of the emergence of a new patriarchy that sought to address the woman question through the idea of new woman. The nationalist construction of simplistic and reductive binaries like home, world, spiritual, material, east, west, feminine, masculine, in its selective approach to modernity, betrayed an anxiety not only of losing ground to the alien colonial powers, but also to allocate our proper space to the various quote-unquote fragments of the nation. I owe this space to what Chatterjee fragments of the nation. The middle class discourse of new woman, though marked only relatively incomplete freedom for women, who in this concept are allowed to be educated, even westernized to an extent in their conduct in the public sphere, but never at the cost of jeopardizing what was perceived as the essentially feminine domain of domesticity, the spiritual heaven of Indianness, a sacrosanct private space still unconquered by the alien cultural onslaught. Way back in 1859 came out Sushila Rupakkhan by Madhusudan Mukhopadhyay, which offered the quintessential manual for the middle class Indian woman. It is also to be remembered in this context that Bodhno Porichoy, the popular and revered Bengali primer, written by the great champion of women's education and liberation in the early 19th century Bengal, Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, published only 4 years before Sushila Rupakkhan in 1855, also did not have any place for girl children. The identity of the Hindu Bhadralok new woman had as its others the Western woman, Mem Sahib, the uneducated, unrefined women of the Arya generations, and lower class women in the Choto Lok. The educated, partly free, yet restricted new category of the Bhadra Mohila was projected as the domestic incarnation of Lokshmi, the Hindu goddess of wealth, domestic peace, and prosperity. As Dipesh Chakraborty suggests, Lokshmi in this discourse embodied Dharma, as opposed to her antithesis, Alokhi, representing Adharma, who in turn was obliquely associated with the figures of the PB, an over-westernized woman, or the Beshra, the prostitute, whose positioning in the imagined geography of the nation posed crucial problems. This brings us to another important marker in the middle-class Hindu nationalist construct of femininity, along with class, race, age, and education, namely sexuality. Patriarchal power in many cultures functions through a denial of female sexuality, whether through the valorization of the desexualized mother figure, goddess Lokhi or Virgin Mary, or through condemnation of perceived sexual excess or promiscuity in the Beshra or the Bibi. Rea, of course, was not a common Hindu, but a Brahmo Hindu, a community known from its inception in the 1940s as a progressive, reformative socio-religious group. In his adult life, he assumed an important role as a leader of the Sadharan Brahmo Samaj. The historian Shushobhan Sarkar, a junior member of the various groups reformed in the last few years of his life, reminisces that Ray was completely immersed in the ideas and the ideologies of the Sadharan Brahmo Samaj. Sadharan Brahmo Samaj, as we all know, was a faction of the Brahmo Samaj inaugurated by Shivnath Shastri in the 1880s. However, it is to be noted that by the time Ray was born, the glorious progressive legacy of Brahmo Samaj was already on the wane, and by the time he held an important position in the Samaj, it had reached its nadi. So much so that even Bama Bodhini Patrika, a Brahmo periodical dedicated to the social uplift and enlightenment of women, adopted a typically conservative stance on the nationalist ideal of the good Indian woman. The progressive periodical wrote in Tarosho Agaro Banglashal, that's 1904, the wife who, like goddess Lokhi, worships her husband as if he is God Hori, will go to heaven after her death and will taste every happiness along with her husband, just as God Hori and Goddess Lokhi enjoy eternal bliss. It was difficult to distinguish the Samaj anymore from the culture of the majority, the run-of-the-mill Hindus, with its attitude to issues of social modernity reflecting little originality or marks of liberal progressivism. In fact, it is the puritanical angle of their character, or the socio-morally conservative aspect of which the Brahmos were particularly marked, which started to gain predominance around the turn of the century. Even in the 1910s, Lila Mazumdar tells us, Lila Mazumdar was Sukumar Rai's sister. Even in the 1910s, Lila Mazumdar tells us, many Brahmos shunned the morally suspect public theatre. And we know that public theatre emerged in Bengal as early as the 1870s. Music was no less suspect, which would be associated with the salons of the Baijis, the wives, and notch girls. And thus, Brahmo women started to take their toddler steps in the world of public singing only in the 1910s. And remember that Abol Tabol would start to come out in the pages of Shondesh in 1913. So this is roughly the time frame of Sukumar Rai's composition of the poems of Abol Tabol. So yes, so no theater, no music for the Brahmos, apparently the most progressive of the Hindu popular groups in contemporary Calcutta. Reba Rai, the first Bhadra Mohila public dancer, took the stage in the 1920s. Lila Mazumdar writes about Reba Rai's first public performance on the stage. I quote, "The only parts of her body that were visible were those above the collarbone and below the elbow and the ankle. Yet the entire city was aghast that a girl from the Bhadralok family danced on the stage." This is 1920s, 1922 actually. forget about participation in games and sports. Othulok women presented themselves as spectators at Eden Gardens for the first time in 1922. To put it in a nutshell, all avenues of self-expression and self-fashioning in the public space were tightly barred for the Hindu and Brahmo middle-class women. It was all about being the ideal Bhadramahila by confining oneself to the domestic sphere, where around this time, even Tagore's Galpogucho was a taboo for girls because of moral reasons. What takes the cake, though, is Sushobhan Sarkar's anecdote that none other than Tagore's own Brahmohood was seriously questioned in 1921 by a substantial section of the members of the Sadharan Brahmo Samaj, presumably because he composed love songs. So composing love songs was a kind of sin from the perspective of the majority of the so-called progressive people of the Brahmo Samaj. So you can easily think of the state of progressivism or state of modernity in contemporary larger Kolkata or even Bengal. So such was the state of Brahmo radicalism and Kolkata Hindu Bhadralok subjectivity, of which Sukumari was a part in the 1910s and the 20s, around the twilight of the long history of the so-called Bengal Renaissance. At the same time, a brief exploration of the activities and composition of the various clubs and groups revealed for in the first two decades of the last century can help us to gather a fair bit of idea about his personal attitude to the dominant nationalist gender ideology. They founded Monday Club, a nonsense club, at his own initiative, and Chhatra Samaj, Jubok De Prarthana Sabha, and several fraternities under the aegis of the Brahmo Samaj. These groups consisted mainly of family members and close friends, most of whom were members of the Brahmo Samaj. His clubs and fraternities were marked by a distinctive feature. Despite the abundant presence of highly educated and cultured ladies in the families of Ray himself and other members of the groups, these associations were exclusively male bastions. Ray's maternal uncle Prabhat Chandra Gangopadhyay, a member of the Monday Club, informs us, I quote from Gangopadhyay, there never was any female member in the club. Hence, Shubhpropha Devi, that is Ray's wife, herself a distinguished and cultured lady, never became one, unquote. Producing an elaborate list of delicacies enjoyed by the sessions of the club, he adds, that's Gangopadhyay, Prabhat Chandra Gangopadhyay adds, I quote again, women of the households painstakingly prepared these delicacies for the sessions. Shukuma's wife was an exceptionally accomplished cook who'd entertain the guests with a wide range of foodstuff, unquote. Presumably, in keeping with the ideology of the Hindu and Brahmo enlightened middle class, women were restricted within the private sphere of domesticity, seldom, quote unquote, allowed to participate in the cultural and religious activities of the public domain, and contributed to them only through entertaining and satisfying the appetites of their men. Ray's idea of the good woman, thus, was essentially compatible with the model of the Brahmo Puritan and Hindu nationalist new woman, a woman subjected to a new patriarchy, educated, even working, but dignified and distant, without any excess in the public space. Thus, to the series of binary oppositions active in the mainstream middle-class nationalist gender ideology pointed out by Bharti Chatterjee and Dipesh Chakraborty, Ray adds another one, levity, as opposed to gravity, depth, spirituality, private, or woman. Levity in his conception was also associated with the perceived sexual excess of all of your bad women. It is thus only reasonable that Ray would actively participate in dramatic performances in London organized by a Mrs. Roy to raise funds for scholarships for girls from India, and at the same time express strong reservations about the militant feminist movement for suffrage that hit the London streets at that time. Apparently, for its transgression of the prescribed code of conduct for the good woman, yes, apparently for its transgression, that is the movements, the feminist movement's transgression of the prescribed code of conduct for the good woman. A letter, not only does he describe the movement as fashionable nuisance, this is Ray in a letter about the feminist movement in London. He not only does he describe the movement as a fashionable nuisance, but shows signs of being particularly disturbed by the fact that the militant women all belonged to the families of gentlemen, Bhadralokermi. Clearly, the Arnoldian distinction between an elite, refined, cultivated, exclusive, private, and above all, quote unquote, apolitical culture, and the subaltern, crude, public, and quote unquote, political anarchy was operative behind such a perception. Let us also remember in this context that the Victorian notion of culture was the most desirable signature characteristic of the figure of the Bhadralok and distinguished him from both the preceding 19th century category of the Babu and the contemporary category of the Chotolo. Foreign ideas received through English education and already existing indigenous discourses thus joined hands in creating an essential exclusive blueprint of modern Bengali subjectivity and also, by extension, of post-colonial Indian identity. In this time, within his family space, which was progressive and pro-reform about the woman question, within the parameters of the Brahmo cultural legacy and Hindu cultural nationalist intervention, there was no gender discrimination in early childhood in terms of education, sports, and cultural activities. However, discriminations against girls started to rear their ugly heads during later childhood and early adolescence. Young girls would slowly but surely be initiated into domestic chores and desirable cultural embellishments like music and painting, while their male counterparts would indulge in artistic pursuits without other moderations. Such an arrangement was consistent with the prescriptions of Mary Carpenter, the renowned British social reformer who worked in tandem with the early Brahmo leaders towards the education and enlightenment of Hindu women in the 1860s and 70s. Carpenter prescribed floristry, music, painting, light exercises, and natural philosophy as ideal subjects for the Hindu girls' school curriculum. The familial culture of dramatic performances under the aegis of the young Ray thus would emerge as an exclusively male domain, with young men as actors and girls only as logistical supporters and spectators. It is no wonder then all but one of Ray's plays would be of an exclusively male cast. The Nonsense Club, the first of the long list of Ray's religio-cultural grandchildren, was founded in 1904 when he was 17 years of age, and his sister Punnalata was 15. Punnalata wraps up her childhood memoir, Chelebela Dinguli, with an account of this Nonsense Club, of a growing gender rift between them boys and us girls, and an ironic statement. This is the last sentence of this book, Chelebela Dinguli: "We were no children." She was to be married off shortly in 1908 at the age of 19. At the same time, Ray found the nationalist and Brahmo puritanical notion of Buddha and embodying the person of his maternal grandmother, Kadambori Gangopadhyay, the first woman graduate along with Chandramukhi Bosu and the first lady doctor of Bengal, one of the first delegates of the Congress Party, and an exceptionally qualified woman in the domestic sphere, who gave birth to at least 5 children and brought up at least 7. In his hagiographic account of his father, Ray narrates the genealogy of his family from his great grandfather, enumerating in proud spirit their accomplishments, but never mentions any of the women in the family, from great grandmother right down to his mother. He barely mentions his mother while talking about his father's marriage. Such nuggets of information, in my mind, provide us with important clues towards understanding the real state of progressivism in the late 19th, early 20th century Brahmo consciousness, as well as the contradictions in the emergent Bengali Hindu middle class orthodox identity. It is also well known that Ray was fully conversant with the Victorian English education, as well as the American tradition of children's literature. His ideational transaction with the works of the likes of Lewis Carroll and Edward Lear being quite important. Scientific children's literature along gender lines started to take England as early as the 1860s, the heyday of imperial prowess, the ideological inspirations behind which worked in consonance with the binary of the home and the world. It was expected that worldly matters like the expansion and able management of the empire would be taken up by men, ably supported by the British women from behind, who take care of the home and thus strengthen and consolidate the British domestic or national character. January 1879 thus saw the publication of the first gendered periodical of juvenile English literature, the Boy's Own Paper, that crossed the million subscriptions within a year's time. That was quite expected in the age of imperialism. And this Boy's Own Paper went on to inculcate imperial ideology and even racist and aggressive nationalist values among British boys right up to 1967. The Girl's Own Paper hit the stands the very next year, 1980. Edward G. Salmon wrote in 1886, "Continuing the gender in the realm of literature, I quote from Salmon, boys boast literature of their very own, as they thought. So if the son has enlisted in his service such able pens, such as those of Reed, Henty, Vaughan, Kingsley, Aymont, Hughes, Hope, Hodgetts, Ballantyne, Freke, Reed, Stevens,
It seems, unfortunately, our speaker has got disconnected. No, he has come back again.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Welcome there. Hello.
Yes. Can we can hear you. Please continue.
Yes. I'll take another 5-6 minutes, I guess.
Please continue. No problem.
Yes. So among the girls' favorites in continental England, late 19th century England, we mentioned Madams Alcott, Dodge, Marshall, Banks, Brown, etc., and the other names. Such stratification of authorship and readership along ideological lines is remarkable, to say the least. It is only a matter of conjecture how far the race gendering of children's literature was inspired by such Western politics of straitjacketing and essentialization in an age of continuous traffic of ideas between the East and the West among the poor Kathak population. Come back to Abulka, finally. The poems in this collection are mostly caricatures of idiosyncratic adult men in the public sphere, which was marked by an element of excess in which women had little role to play. Middle-class adult women, or the Bhadra Mohilas in this imaginary, were too good, too respectable and motherly, and too distant from any association with frivolity to be made fun of. The old lady in Budirbari, being well past prime, and a lower class woman too, presumably a slum dweller, is probably exempt from the code of conduct in place for ideal Bhadra Mohila. She could be therefore safely made fun of. The bride in Shokpatru is virtually absent, concealed within the domestic boundaries, while her prospective marriage in the laughingstock of Gangaram is being deliberated upon by two men, either out in the open, in the public space, or in the outer sanctum of the homestead, the living room. The mother playing with her child in the open air, in Kuture Khela, is not human at all, only a ghost. The only other woman in the collection who is said to have appeared in the public space, presumably a mature woman, Keshto Dashe Pishi in Kathakutuguru, is again a working class woman, a vegetable seller, a chotolok, and therefore excluded from the Bhadrok nationalist discourse of ideal womanhood and nationality. The young people in the collection, on the other hand, are either past their early childhood or well within their adolescence, when boys would begin to step out into public space and girls would start to get confined within the domestic sphere. To violate such a well-based order and social code of conduct, even the spirit of fun and revelry would have sent undesirable signals to raise adolescent readers of Shondesh, the formation of whose class and gender identity was already under process. The goodness desired of the good Bhadrulok girls hardly allows them to be naughty, mischievous, or flamboyant enough in the public space to figure in today's world of male cacophony, modeled upon the Western genre of schoolboy stories. They are too decorous to indulge in any sort of frivolity or revelry, to have fun or be made fun of, too nice to be brought down to the heroically mundane world of Pagla Dashu. It may not be altogether a coincidence that Satish Chandra Chakraborty's Shantaner Charitra Gathan, one of the most popular of the innumerable child-rearing manuals, describing rules for producing ideal future citizens of the nation that inundated the 19th and the late 19th and 20th century Bengali book market, would be published in 1912, just 3 years before the poems of Abul Tabul started to appear in Shondesh. The book begins, that is Abul Tabul begins, and ends with two poems with the same title, Abul Tabul, that function respectively as the prologue, a prologue which was customary to many 19th century English children's literature books. For example, we can remember Edward Lear's collection of nonsense verses, or Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland. All these books had a prologue in them. They all began with a prologue. So, as if Reza Abul Tabul also has a prologue in the form of this poem, Abul Tabul, the introductory poem called Abul Tabul. And also there's this another poem named Abul Tabul at the end of the volume, which can be tentatively treated as the epilogue to the volume. The first one, Aire Bhula Khyal Khula Shapon Dola Nachiyar, introduces the reader to the spirit of the book and welcomes him to what is at least at one level the realm of the meaningless, the world without any rhyme or reason. While the last one, Meghmuluke Jhapsharate Ramdhunuke Rabcharate, portrays, literally as well as metaphorically, the climax and denouement of the entire pursuit. The experience of reading the series of poems is like that in a hall of feasting, a music or theater hall marked by a formal entrance and exit. What is particularly interesting for us in the present context is the politics of the marvelous illustrations accompanying the poems. both these illustrations, first of all, depict an open public forum. Secondly, in the illustration for the first poem, one finds a group of people holding up aloft the signboard of the world of fantasy, nonsense, and escape from debilitating bondages of various sorts. While the illustration for the last poem shows the effect of the entire exercise, celebration of the newfound world of absolute freedom, reader spirit immersed in nuclear bliss, free from the clutches of the hard empirical realist, the scientist, or the pedantic scholar. What is striking in these otherwise deep works of art, presenting promise and materialization in the respective figures present in the collections of the book and male. Promotion and protection of the world of fun, frolic, and whimsy in the public sphere, playing truant to participate in that world of revelry represented by the boy in the second picture, and playing spoiled sport to put a spanner in the whole enterprise, as done by the scholar or scientist in the second picture, are all necessarily for the male prerogatives in this imaginative world. Both freedom and bondage here are spaces controlled by this minority group, almost replicating with astonishing fidelity the culture of performances in their own family space and in the prevailing public sphere. The flight of fantasy remains no more pure and unproblematic. If race, world of gendered imagination abominable is so essential in no woman's land, the generic nonsense here becomes suspect, comedy impure, laughter cruel and one-sided, and the ideal androgynous creative mind non-existent. It is only towards the end of his life that women came to figure in the groups formed under race leadership. And let's remember that they died pretty young, at the age of 36 alone. So it was in the fourth and final fraternity that they founded under the aegis of the Brahmo Samaj, the social fraternity, not in the earlier devotional, educational, and literary, that young women enrolled alongside men as late as 1921-22, only one that before race. Untimely demise. In the secretary of the fraternity was a woman writer of the time, Sita Chattopadhyay, daughter of the renowned Prabhashi editor, who subsequently raised only direct comment on the gender issue just a few months before his death in the long pamphletary poem Otite Chobi, in a morbid nostalgic, even revivalist mood of passionate glorification. He hails what he claims to have been the notion of the ideal Samaj in the era of the Brahmo leader Keshav Chandra Sen in the 1870s, a Samaj free from any hierarchies, including the gender. I quote from Otite Chobi by Sukumar Rai, Keshav Apon Prutibha Bole, Gatone Gothilo Jubok Dol. This is another Sukumar Rai, a different kind of poem. Aesthetically very poor, of course, because it's didactic, it's pamphleteering, it's only propagandist in nature, far away from the world of the nonsense children's writer Sukumar Rai, who we are mostly familiar with. So this is Dada Sukumar, the leader Sukumar, the propagandist Sukumar, the serious Sukumar. Keshav Apon Prutibha Bole, Chori Gothilo Jubok Dol, Nagore Nagore Bolo Prachar, Harmura Chitnahi Jati Bichar, Nahi Bhed Hetha Na, যেটা নারী ও নয় ভক্তি আছে যার সে যায় তবে কুরীতি যত ভাঙি দাও চিরদিনের মতো ধর্মে ধর্মে বিরোধ রবে মহা সমন্বয় গঠিত হবে ভেরি ব্যাড পোয়েট্রি ইন ইট বাট দ্যাটস নট আ পয়েন্ট হিয়ার অফ কোর্স ইভেন দিস অ্যাসক্রিপশন অফ ইগালিটেরিয়ানিজম টু দি ব্রাহ্মণ সমাজ ইন দি ইরা অফ কেশব চন্দ্র ইজ প্র্যাকটিক্যালি নট কোয়াইট টেনেবল বাট কেশবাই ফ্র্যাকশন অফ দি ব্রাহ্মণ সমাজ ওয়াজ নোন টু বি লার্জলি কনজারভেটিভ অফ নেট লগারহেডস উইথ দি প্রোগ্রেসিভ ব্রাহ্মণ গ্রুপ that came up with their women's organization, Bongo Mohila Samaj. Finally, they entered a democratic space here that accommodates equally in the spheres of caste, race, and gender. Jati, Ormo, Lingo. All these words are, or not Lingo, nor Unhari. So all these words appear in this particular quotation. But they're breathing out the final frontier of the Bengali post-colonial subjectivity class. All said and done, all radicalisms duly observed, the Bhadrlok identity and hegemony remains sacrosanct, with the Bartola Desh languishing in the world of oblivion. Ray's comment, however, shows his sensitivity to the ideological linkers of Bengali colonial modernity, no matter how nascent, at the very end of his life, an awareness that could have manifested itself through his creative impulse had fate allowed it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh Das Thakur. Thank you indeed for this brilliant presentation through which you have so, you know, insightfully problematized our very own Sukumar Rai by locating him in the complex late 19th and early 20th century world of, you know, Bengali colonial modernity, nationhood, gender, his engagement meant with the question of gender, or at least maybe non-engagement with the woman question. Thank you indeed. We have a few questions ready, which have arrived in the YouTube live chat. So I'll just ask you, I can't ask all questions because, as we all know, time is limited. Yes. Stella Bishash, from who is a research scholar of Gujarat, has asked two questions. So I'm reading those two questions. How would you view the ramifications of such gendered discourses upon the reconfiguration of native childhood in colonial Bengal? This is the first question. And the second one, how do these gendered notions develop in the post-independence developments in Bengali juvenile literature? Dr. Das Thakur.
Probably I'll be able to answer this question satisfactorily when I attempt to write two books on these two topics. These are not questions that can be answered right now in this particular session. They demand book-length answers, actually, book-length projects. Innumerable books are available in the market on these two subjects. I guess the questioner can consult those books, because this is very, very fascinating, very, very challenging domain where relations between various ideologies, not only gender, class, modernity, subjectivity, etc., and the ramifications in the world of children's literature, as well as in the formations of the discourse of childhood, family, nationhood, they've been treated in some detail in innumerable works, really, in the world of post-colonial literary criticism, post-colonial sociology, historical works, and so on and so forth. So, yes, that would be my humble response for the time being here. Ritonga, please unmute yourself.
Thank you. The third question is from Rajorshi Mukherjee. I'm sorry, I missed the information that he must have sent about himself, so I know only his name now. What role does the body play in Abul Tabul, keeping in mind the various distortions of the human body, both as subjects of many poems and illustrations as well?
That's a wonderful question, really. Yes. This is not really about the body of human beings, it's also about animal bodies, really. In general, Ray was very interested in the dissection of things, dissection of bodies, dissection of ideas. As we all know, he was a man from the discipline of science. So keen observation and the possibility of various permutations and combinations was always explored by him in real life, as well as in his poetic corpus. He was fond of creating various sorts of games, various sorts of plays, by means of incorporating elements from various games. So that was one kind of inventiveness. And this kind of collage making, or this kind of montage making, was a part and parcel of his personality, really. If one reads autobiographical accounts from left by members of the Ray family, one finds innumerable such games where elements from a course of conduct from various different games are brought together to create, to invent Newtons. Similar ideas are brought into play in the world of Abul Tabul, not only Abul Tabul, many other collections of Sukumar Rai. So where the body, human body, is a subject, as a subject of representation. And most importantly, human body is dissected at times. Human body is dissected. Human body is often seen not in its entirety. This is one example of the keen observational power of Sukumar Rai. And at the same point of time, his play with language, play with words, for example. One readily remembers the poem Pishi Bhashen Chokher Jale Putno Kota Pele, Allah Dete Pashir Bari Atkhana Hoy Chele, and so on and so forth. If you remember the illustration, he literally shows the body of the young boy being mutilated into 8 different pieces. So literalization of language, okay, the language which has multiple layers, the metaphorical language is brought into play at the literal level. So in this way, the play of language, body becomes very, very interesting. At the same point of time, he plays with animal bodies, for example, khichuri, okay, hybrid bodies. So this kind of hybridization of the colonial body or hybridization of the animal body or human body at another level might indicate that, I'm not very sure, in my opinion, that would be somewhat a kind of overrating, but that would be raise response to the contemporary culture of hybridity itself, okay, and identity crisis. It may also be read as a kind of a manifestation of raised awareness of the dominant discourse of identity crisis in contemporary Bengali subjectivity. So who am I? What am I? What does my body represent? Am I in my body? Okay. So this kind of preoccupation with one's own body, other people's bodies, other animals' bodies. So these all, on the one hand, refer to his keen observational spirit. Number two, his engagement with the idea of identity, physical identity, cultural identity. And of course, his scientific spirit, finally. That would be my submission.
I think Dr. Srimanto Das, whom we can see on the screen, has a question for you.
Well, sir, thank you really for the wonderful lecture. I have a question.
Srimanto, we can't hear you properly. Yes. Please use the microphone properly. We can't hear you properly.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes. Now it's okay.
Okay. Sir, did the deification of women that was prevalent in 19th century Bengali literature, for example, the novels of Bankimchandra Chattopadhyay, play a role in the exclusion of women in Ray's nonsense poetry? I guess even Vidyasagar excluded them in his stories in Bonna Poricha. Does that make nonsense a tool for criticizing patriarchal assumptions? I mean, if we take the absence as significant and meaningful. It is interesting because Ray was influenced by the works of Lewis Carroll, whose novels in effect talk about the entry of a girl, Alice, into Wonderland, which is actually a caricature of the patriarchal public domain. What are your views, sir?
Yes, absolutely. I completely agree with you on these points. First of all, yes, your invocation of Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland is very instructive because, as you rightly pointed out, that yes, Alice engaged with many of the patriarchal assumptions of the time. But interestingly, remember how kind of readapted Alice in Wonderland into his own Bengali-sized work, that is Bhojobarul. Bhojobarul is modeled upon Alice in Wonderland, but interestingly, in the process of Bengalicization or adaptation or appropriation or indigenization of this English literary work, Ray beautifully replaces the female figure in Alice in Wonderland by a male figure, a male figure over here. So the protagonist here is a boy rather than a girl, okay? Because this boy is kind of exploring the outer space, okay? Remember that Bhojobarul is not located inside the domestic space, it's not inside the house, okay? So it's out in the open, in the garden. So garden, remember the imagery of the garden, the metaphor of the garden, or the space of the garden also figures very, very prominently in Alice novels. But there, the garden is inhabited by, explored by, enjoyed by, savored by the girls, not only Alice, but also her elder sister. But in this particular case, it's a boy. But then again, it's not merely about I guess it's not merely about race, idiosyncratic personal choice. Okay, it's a kind of cultural compulsion, I guess. So that was the larger culture which inspired Ray and probably many other contemporary producers of children's literature to make that kind of gesture or that kind of compromises or innovations, etc. In the sphere of children's literature. And so far as your idea of deification of women in Bonkim Chandra's novels is concerned, that point I also made in this presentation, because I was talking about the desexualization of the female body, of women's body in the late nationalist culture, the emergence of the idea of the mother, okay, the not only the deification of the mother, but also deification of the motherland, the idea of the nation as mother. So all these are kind of discourses which are implicated within each other. So Bonkim Chandra is the first person to have introduced the discourse of nation as mother. So nation to be worshipped. Okay. So mothers to be worshipped. So the figure of Kali, figure of Maja Hoiya Chen, Maja Hoiben, and so on and so forth. So these discourses abound in not only Bonkim Chattopadhyay, but in the works of innumerable other late 19th century Bengali, especially Hindu or Brahmo nationalist figures. So clearly, there's a kind of long baggage of history behind Sukumar Rai's back. So a person, no matter how radical he is, he or she is, no matter how... Yes. Yes, are you saying something, Dr. Blush?
No.
Yes. So no matter how radical, how unique, or how kind of out of the box thinking of kind of person one may be, one at the end of the day is a product of the context. One cannot completely kind of overcome, okay, all the contradictions of the time one belongs to, or the place one belongs to. So Ray is unique. Ray questions innumerable such hierarchies, which I did not choose to mention because Shivaji Bandyopadhyay and many other people have already talked about them in great detail. So I wanted to kind of shed light on the other Ray, which has been comparatively less addressed. So yeah, that discourse was definitely there, and together, this is how tradition is formed. As Eliot told us, in tradition, individual talent. Individual talents definitely leave their mark, but they cannot function outside the tradition. In the process, they themselves enrich the tradition, they themselves contribute towards inventing the tradition, and they get shaped by the tradition themselves. So this is how, through the imprints left by innumerable literary writers, adult writers, or adults writers, serious writers, humorous writers, children's writers, Bengali children's literature, tradition of Bengali children's literature has been formed. So yes, I completely agree with your ideas.
We really don't have much time, so I'm sure there are many other questions. All of them, obviously. I can see that there's one question from Shoma Rai on translations of Sukumar Rai's poems. So may I request her to reserve this question for the second speaker, because as I know, the second speaker will speak exclusively on the translation aspect of Sukumar Rai's poetry. I'll just take one more question. This is from Uma Rai Srinivasan. She says, shall be much obliged if you kindly mention books to help read more extensively on one, the times, and two, the Rai family. Books.
You want a reading list, a bibliography? Look, there are innumerable books to read about the time. Okay, so innumerable books on children's literature in particular. But so far as books on Ray family are concerned, there are not many available in the market. I can talk about only a few memoirs and autobiographical works, apart from works by Ray himself and by Satyajit Ray and Ray's father, Upendu Kishore Rai Choudhury. There are works by Vila Mojumdar, Punnalata Chakraborty, and a few others. Not all of them are even available in the market, because these are some of the most well-known works produced by the members of this family. But there are certain other works which are produced by other members of the family, but which are not available in the market. So these are the only few works which to my knowledge, exist to explore Ray's personal life, his personal takes on certain things, etc. But so far as the contemporary times are concerned, 19th century, the world of 19th century Bengal Renaissance are concerned, and books abound in the market, there are innumerable books. Then just Google Bengal Renaissance and you get many. I mean, look, there are various aspects of the Bengal Renaissance: social reforms, politics, economics, history writing, narratives, music, painting, religious movements, Brahmo movement, and innumerable other traditions. And books are there in all possible fields. So one cannot possibly kind of give you three or a list of 3, 4, 5 books which can help you to kind of know all these things in a kind of nutshell.
Well, thank you once again, Dr. Dash Thakur, for your presentation. And I guess we can now move on to the second speaker. Translation of poetry, any translator knows, is quite a challenging task. But translating nonsense poetry certainly is far more challenging. I don't know whether that is one of the reasons why Abul Tabul was left untranslated by translators for almost 50 years after its publication, till Satyajit Ray himself tried his hand at it in 1970, I guess. Our next speaker will foreground issues relating to the translation of Sukumar Rai's works in his presentation. I am highly privileged to present before you Sri Rindon Kundu. Sri Rindon Kundu is presently working as an assistant professor of English at Sri Sri University, Odisha. He was elected as the treasurer of Comparative Literature Association of India, the CLAI. He has been awarded several international grants like IATIS 2018 Hong Kong Bursary by International Association of Translation and Intercultural Studies, full grant by the British Academy to participate in the African Translation and Interpreting Studies Writing Workshop at South Africa in 2019, and also the Young Researcher Travel Grant 2019 by European Society for Translation Studies. He has recently been selected for the Volkswagen Stiftung 2021 grant. The title of his presentation today is Translation, Humor, and Sukumar. Sri Rindon Kundu, please.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, I'm immensely thankful to the Department of English, Haldia Government College, for giving me this huge honor of speaking in a webinar of this scale. I'm particularly thankful to respected principal, Professor Biju Tripathi, Professor Pritham Bondhobadhyay and his colleagues at the Department of English for inviting me in this brilliantly conceptualized webinar. And I also thank Professor Dash Thakur for introducing Sukumar Rai and locating his work within the corpus of Bengali literature. However, I will approach Sukumar Rai through translation, especially the translation of Hojobodola. Using the Western epistemological concept of translation, I'll try to look at the process of translating the nonsense. Now, we all know that from time immemorial, translation has been described as transfer of meaning, either through the route of word for word or sense for sense method. Translation studies scholars for a long time were completely biased about the analysis of the original and then transferring the meaning of the original by restructuring it as close as possible. Equivalence, copy, mimesis, reflection, mirroring are all those attached by the translation theorists to determine the perfect transferring of the original sense in the target language so that the translated text can claim authenticity in respect to the process of translation. While purists were deeply concerned about the purity, equivalent words, and keeping the original meaning, the experimentalists, on the other hand, were much more interested in adaptation, deviation from the original, and dethroning the superiority of the original over the translation. They were trying to theorize the dependency of the original over its translation, as well as translator's authority over his or her translation. The issue of translator's subjectivity was trying to push aside the question of equivalence. The deconstructionists, the cultural translator, the post-colonial thinker all came together and started raising questions of untranslatability, the domestication of the text into target culture, and the false indebtedness of the translator to the original author. If we try to trace the etymological root of the word nonsense, we'll see that the term meant something which is lacking in sense. Language are words without meaning or conveying absurd or ridiculous ideas. From the prefix non, not plus sense. Since mid-20th century, this nonsense with the hyphen has been used to distinguish the meaning that which is not sense, that which is different from sense, not implying absurdity. Hence, the way the concept of nonsense has tried to translate the apparent seriousness of the society into humor challenges the concept of sense for sense rendition associated with translation from the beginning. Although, according to Kathleen Pendlebury, as she stated in her book Reading Nonsense, that nonsense does not mean mere lack of sense. Rather, it's a kind of symbolic language that can be reconciled into meaning. It has to maintain an equilibrium between the presence and the absence of meaning, between the sense side on the one hand and the essential paradox, ambiguity, and amicable nonsensicality on the other. Therefore, nonsense writing is never intended to make formal sense. Nevertheless, it has a kind of internal lunatic logic of its own and often comprises enigmatic variations on the absurd. As translations has been seen close reading, nonsense as a literary genre refuses to be conventional to the expected order of things. It pokes fun at logical reasoning and prioritizes conventional language use by emphasizing sounds, rhythms, wordplay, and the grammatical principle, the signifier-signified conventions. Nonsense also reveals how translation has been conceived of in terms of a literal identity of meaning. Urmishi Bedamatta, in her paper titled Playing with Nonsense, argued that the focusing on nonsense literature and its translation, we can tackle dilemmas related to untranslatability, puns, language games, and the impossibility of the meaninglessness and the necessity of misunderstanding. So translation of nonsense literature and its interactive discussion in the classroom can help the teachers to make linguistic connections and discoveries in a multilingual classroom in India. Now, the genre of literature regarded as nonsense translates the social reality into an absurd humor. However, this is no way disregards or trivializes the pressing issues of the contemporary society. On the contrary, it is a result of serious reflection and deep reaction towards it, only presented in a non-conventional way. Hence, it is no way a parody, rather it problematizes the logical and normative social system of the Bengali Bhadralok community and turns its apparent seriousness upside down, thereby bringing home the serious social reality in an inverted manner. Therefore, translation occurs here in two levels. Number one, translation of the social reality into humor by the invention inversion of the lens, which I would like to call translation into nonsense. And then, secondly, translation of this nonsense, where the text created in the source language is translated in the target language, passing through the subjectivity of the translator. However, at both these levels, the sense-for-sense rendition associated with the practice of translation from time immemorial gets problematized. Although the basic premise on which this genre of literature is built entails making sense of the reality, but the aim is fundamentally that of reproducing it through an inverted lens. Hence, the concept of equivalence in translation, which essentially requires equality on both sides, is destroyed at the surface level. The sense of the source, which is society and its practices in this case, is translated into nonsense using language and humor. Although a deeper analysis justifies the reflection on the serious issue and its unconventional representation. But apparently, the practice of writing problematizes the concept of equivalence based on sense for sense. The source text gets inverse related to the target text. Now, since translation does not happen in a vacuum, there is, of course, a larger impetus that triggers the author to describe the society using inverted lenses. Finding answer for it will make us confront the larger question, which is why nonsense was needed at all as a method of representation. The answer to this could be pursued using the Scopus theory, which is the function, which discusses the function in translation studies, and how a text plays in the literary convention and the society as a whole. In the case of translation of nonsense literature from one language to the other, which Raymond Williams would have called translation proper, the most interesting aspect is the interpretation of the source text by the translator so as to render it in the target language, retaining its absurdity and humor. Gayatri Spivak points out that the act of translation is an intimate act of reading. Hence, in the case of translation of the nonsense, the translator has to derive the sense embedded deep inside the nonsense so as to render it as nonsense in another language. This rendering, although apparently nonsense, should make sense when analyzed deeply in the target language as well. Therefore, the process of translation will mean interpretation of sense from nonsense to as to render it as nonsense from which a deep sense of meaning can be generated. Along with this, the translator has to retain the sense of humor intact so as to appeal to both the adult and young readers. And it is quite evident in the translator's preface of The Select Nonsense of Sukumar Rai, where Sukanta Chowdhury has stated, quote, "Clever men might debate whether nonsense can be translated, but I reassure myself that at worst, the result will still be nonsense. All the same, I have left out 8 poems from the Rhymes Without Reason and a few short passages from Topsy-Turvy Tale. The omissions either relate to untranslatable points of Bengali idiom or else appear to lose all their fun in translation," unquote. it all comes down to what he or any translator means by nonsense. In the case of nonsense translation, we can see that the translation is happening in two levels. So to translate the apparent seriousness into nonsense to elicit humor by the author, and then the translator is trying to translate the nonsense according to his engagement of similar kinds of sense frustration from one language into another. Now, a translated text to remain still nonsense even after translation, as we know, is the biggest challenge of the translator. And the very success of the nonsense translation depends on the fact how crafty you can be in producing nonsense in another language. Therefore, the very premise of the Western translation, that is, transferring sense, stands defeated. Nonsense translation, I argue, is therefore can be seen as a protest against the Western fanaticism about meaning production through translation. Now, in 1921, you know, 2 years before the untimely death of at the age of 35, Sukumar Rai published Hojo Boro Law, an absurdist tale in Bengali, especially for the young readers. And it has been modeled after Lewis Carroll Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. Hojo Boro Law begins on a hot summer afternoon, like Alice in Wonderland, as you all know. Now, the present paper will try to portray a short comparative study between Sukanta Chowdhury's topsy-turvy tale, published in 1987 by Oxford University Press and forwarded by authors Satyajit Ray, and Sampurna Chatterjee's translation, who kept the original title Hojo Boro Law and then added a subtitle or a twiddle twaddle to do within parentheses, published in 2004 by Puffin Books and forwarded by Ruskin Bond. The reason behind the complete details of publication and forward is to point out the importance of the translations, as Sukumar Rai stands as the finest writer of nonsense tales and verses in Bengali. Both the translators, despite their difference in approaches in translation, kept the sketches and illustrations by Sukumar Rai, as they are the indispensable part of the original as well as translated text, in order to understand the nonsensical world as portrayed by Sukumar Rai. Now, let us see a few examples from the texts. Dastalay Dipi Chhayar Modhe Chupchap Shuye Achi Tobu Gheme Aste. Now, Sampurna Chatterjee translated this line as, "There I was lying quietly in the shade of a tree, hot, bothered, and sweaty." Whereas Sukanta Chowdhury tried to translate the mood, the sense of exhaustion or lack of energy, by translating it as, "I lay in the shade of a tree feeling quite limp." Again, in the next line, "Gham Mujhpar Jonno," became "to fan myself" in Sukanta Chowdhury's version, whereas Sampurna Chatterjee tried to stick to the phrasal act, "to wipe my face," to render it faithfully. Next, "Chilo Rumal Hoye Gelo Ekta Biral." This often quoted phrase from Sukumar Rai's Hojo Boro Law, Sukanta Chowdhury preferred to stick to the linguistic sense of metamorphosis and used therefore the verb "turn into," whereas Sampurna Chatterjee used the sense of time gap, "a hanky 1 minute, a cat the next. Chandrabindu Cha Birale Talibosha Rumaler Ma Holo Chashma. Sukanta Chowdhury translated this as, "S for semicolon, T for handkerchief, C for cat, and that's the way to spell spectacles," which tries to capitulate the nonsensical sequence of the original. Sampurna Chatterjee, on the other hand, instead of translating Chandrabindu, as any punctuation mark, translated it as emperor, and from there she has invented a completely new sequence. The emperor's M, cat's E's, and handkerchief's chief. And what does it make? Mischief. But while mentioning these spatial markers, both the translators kept the original intact. You know, Tibet, Calcutta, Diamond Harbor, Ranaghat, all are in the same way. The next important character, Gecho Dada, becomes cousin Tree Hopper in Sukanta Chaudhary's rendition as he tried to maintain this sibling relationship. But Shampurna Chatterjee made it as Tree Cat. Sukanta's version of the names of characters is especially noteworthy because since he manages to retain the original intention while contextualizing the allusion to more relevant references. While asked by the narrator about the whereabouts of Gecho Dada, the cat answered in a nonsensical, complex way, connecting different spatial points. Sukumar used the common dialectical names like Ulubere, Motihari, Ramkishtapur, Kashim Bazar, which were translated by Shampurna Chatterjee, keeping the exact same spelling, whereas Sukanta Chaudhary used the standard colonial dialect like Kashim Bazar, most probably to show that this text is a product in the colonial time. Now, the translation of nonsense literature is a game involving language and logic, which tries to maintain the balance between sense and nonsense. It defeats the network of meaning on which conventional literature is premised. The established rule of meaning and calculations take a back seat as we enter a world of randomness. The randomness of identity, Beral, Rumal, Chandrabindu, or the place to which one's identity is linked, redealed with indeterminacy, which breaks the certainty of everyday existence. Like Gecho Dada cannot be found at one place. The ultimate or the absolute is jeopardized. Ray is in fact mocking the measured everyday monotonous existence of people. Nonsense brings alive a world that is not bothered about a scheduled life or a system that mechanizes existence. Nonsense literature has a philosophy of its own, according to which the world is huge joke, a mockery. Therefore, translators of the nonsense should have a different worldview along with the required artistic skill. A whimsical way of looking at the world out the shackles of rules, schedules and logic, a world which has meaning but at the same time makes no sense. Beyond this meaning and no meaning lies the world of absurd constructed by the philosophy of nonsense. And I will, the last example that I have cited here, tarpor edike boro montri tin rajya তারপর এদিকে বড়মন্ত্রী তো রাজকন্যা গুড়িসুতো খেয়ে ফেলেছে, কেউ কিছু জানে না। ওদিকে রাক্ষসটা করেছে কি, ঘুমুতে ঘুমুতে হাও মাও কাও, মানুষের গন্ধ পাও বলে হুড়মুড় করে খাট থেকে পড়ে গিয়েছে। সম্পূর্ণ ট্রান্সলেটেড দিস পোর্শন অ্যাজ বাই দেন দ্য চিফ মিনিস্টার হ্যাড সোয়ালোড দ্য প্রিন্সেসেস বল অফ উল, নোবডি হ্যাড দি ফেইন্টেস্ট আইডিয়া দ্যাট দিস ব্যাড হ্যাপেন্ড। অন দি আদার হ্যান্ড, the demon muttering fee 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 fum, I smell the blood of a human, in his sleep had fallen right out of his bed. Sukanta Chaudhary translated it as, meanwhile the head vizier had swallowed the prince's pool of thread, nobody knew about it, and just at this moment along came the man-eating giant roaring as he rolled off the bed in his sleep. It is evident from these two versions that Shampurna Chatterjee has tried to retain the much-used folklore folklorist image of a Rakshas and created an alliterative analogy of hau mau khau, manusher gondho pao in English. Sukanta Chaudhary, on the other hand, refrained from creating such nonsense alliteration, has only added an adjective man-eating as way of defining the significance of the phrase. I'll conclude my paper with the words of Jean-Jacques Le Cercle, a major theorist of nonsense translation. In his essay titled Translate It Not, 2007, published in the first ever volume of the celebrity journal Translation Studies by Routledge, has categorically defined that the possible seven theses of nonsense translation can be: number one, you can't translate nonsense. Thesis number two, you must not translate nonsense. Thesis number three, you need not translate nonsense. Thesis number four, you do not translate nonsense, you transpose it. Thesis number five, nonsense is endlessly translatable. Thesis number six, nonsense is endlessly translated. Thesis number seven, translations of nonsense are the most complete, satisfactory, and successful of all translations. Now, Jean-Jacques Le Cercle, in another essay titled Modalities of Translating Nonsense, 2019, published after 12 years of the first essay in the same journal, has again started with mentioning the seven theses to capture the paradoxes of nonsense translation. First three theses, according to him, capture the following intuition: translating nonsense is a question of grammatical modality combined with negation. You can, may, must, should translate nonsense, and yet you cannot, may not, must not, should not translate it, unquote. In his first three theses, to quote his own words, the modal auxiliary is modified by negation. Nonsense text posits the existence of sense by withdrawing it. I know this is nonsense, but such nonsense presupposes the sense that it denies. I shall therefore envisage the various modalities of translating nonsense by taking the modal auxiliaries in contradictory or combined pairs. As in the apparent paradox of my first modality, you can't, but you must translate nonsense. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sri Rindon Kundu, for your presentation, where you have engaged successfully, very successfully, with all the nuances of nonsense translation and Sukumar Rai. I'll now request my colleagues to come up with questions if there are any. I have with me here two questions, but before that, I'll go back to Soma Rai, who had a question on translation of Sukumar Rai's poetry earlier. So I'm reading her question first, and then I'll go to the other ones. Can the nuances and fissures be found in translations of the poems in Abul Tabul? Can we mention some of this to our students in a simple way? The nuances and fissures which perhaps Dr. Dash Thakur discussed, she was referring to them.
Yes. Yes, obviously there are certain nuances, but what I tried to say, you know, there is the translator's subjectivity playing in these translations. So, you know, I have taken two, there are others, there is recently or by Orunabo. You know, translator's subjectivity varies from person to person, and since the, you know, it is a very subjective position, so obviously the nuances will change. But there are obviously nuances present in the translations which can be cited categorically by a detailed linguistic analysis of all the translations.
Okay, thank you. Please don't take much time to answer this question. This is a question from me because I shouldn't take up the time. I was just wondering when you mentioned, when you compared the translations of Hoja Borolo made by Professor Sukanto Chowdhury and Sampurna Chatterjee, what's your take on the translation of poetry, Sukumara's poetry, Abol Tabol? How would you place the two, these two translators while thinking of Abol Tabol? Because it's poetry, you know, we have the whole world of the meter, yes, to take into consideration.
I have actually concentrated especially on the in this Hoja Borolo. I haven't taken Abol Tabol's, you know, linguistically, but I will come up with this is a very interesting, you know, field of research. The first time I'm presenting on Sukumar Rai, but I will definitely see the, you know, translation variations in translations of the poetry.
Okay, thank you. The next question is from Chompa Ghoshal. It's a rather sweeping question. Is there a relation between nonsense and the absurd?
Absurd would properly mean anything that is illogical. But would consider, you know, nonsense has a logic. I argue, and a conscious attempt by the author, as I have mentioned, a philosophy which has deeper implications. So, yes, that's the relationship between nonsense and nonsense.
Okay. Another question. It's from a person called Debolina. The full name isn't here. The last line in the purloined mustache, Gopchuri, in the original, and the translation in Professor Chowdhury's is quite interesting. In the translation, the last line of Mokchuri.
The translator, when translating a text, interprets it in his own way. Now, he of course tries to achieve some sort of equivalence. However, there are at the same time open to, you know, interpretation by the target readers in their own way. So my opinion would differ from the others, but right now I do not have the text with me.
Okay. The original is, okay. Shall we go to the next question?
Yeah.
Okay. It's from Uma Rai Srinivasan. Can nonsense be considered as a serious and only sensible way the world around, going even beyond the scope of satire, which criticizes while it laughs?
Can you please repeat?
Yes. Can nonsense be considered as a serious and only sensible way of rejecting the world around, going even beyond the scope of satire, which criticizes while it laughs? I guess she wants to mean that can nonsense be even more effective than satire?
Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree with you.
Okay. Thank you. I heard Dr. Dash Thakur's voice just now. So may I request, if you have any observations to make or any question, you are welcome. Shorab, you are welcome to say something. Yeah, I said that if you have any observations to make or anything to ask, you are welcome.
Just a small observation, nothing to ask really.
Yes. Okay.
As I was arguing in my own paper, I mean, this generic nomenclature nonsense, I guess, needs to be revisited, because the moment what nonsense is dropped, okay, the people's attitude changes. Okay, people tend to associate nonsensicality with merely humor, frivolity, fun, childishness, childhood, and so on and so forth. It is high time we started questioning such attitudes. And this is just a kind of ideological strategy, I guess, to appropriate the radical capacities, radical potentials of nonsense. Sukumar Rai should not merely amuse us, entertain us. Unfortunately, in a long tradition, we have reduced Sukumar Rai and certain other producers of children's literature, mainly Sukumar Rai, to the level of mere entertainer. Whenever we talk about Sukumar Rai, we nostalgically go back to our childhood, often forgetting that Sukumar Rai's poetry, his so-called quote-unquote nonsense literature, nonsense rhymes, his plays, his schoolboy narratives, etc., got a lot to offer to the adult people too. Not only in terms of amusement, not only in terms of fun or entertainment, they can enrich us in many other ways. Yes, satire is definitely there, sarcasm is definitely there, various ideological kind of problematizations or engaging into new sets of problems, they're always there. But above all, I guess, it is this multiplicity, it is this heterogeneity or polyphony of the genre of nonsense, vis-a-vis not only Sukumar Rai, but also the producers of nonsense, so-called nonsense in many other cultures like Lear, Carroll and others. So that has not been adequately taken care of by critics, I guess. So that has been somewhat underplayed. So that is really unfortunate. And I guess the generic nomenclature nonsense is somewhat responsible for this kind of undertreatment received by these geniuses, these great authors of so-called nonsense literature. The sooner we can come out of this kind of prejudice, this kind of bias, okay, the better. And that is possibly the only way that we can appreciate the nuances of the so-called nonsense literature in a truly polyphonic fashion. That's all I can offer right now.
So,
I mean, because in many ways, I guess, Sukumar Rai contributed to the tradition of Bangla literature, Bangla poetry, which is no less grave and important than people like Tagore and Jivanananda themselves. So he's a kind of watershed moment. He's a watershed author. Okay, he created and shaped a genre on his own with so much possibilities, with enormous possibilities. So people take certain authors seriously, and probably unwittingly associate certain other authors with frivolity and fun. So that's really unfortunate, I guess. We need to kind of come out of this kind of attitude towards not only the genre, but also towards the authors who are associated with this genre.
Can I just give my observation? I absolutely agree with Professor Dash Thakur completely. Ray had a deeper philosophy. It was not just meant to invoke laughter. One book that I can remember right now that has taken this nonsense very seriously is Sumanna Shatpathy, and there are two more editors, Rishon Tiwasa. But yes, he is very right that, you know, Sukumar Rai somehow has been seen always as a writer of a children's literature, not as a serious, quote-unquote serious kind of writer.
Yeah. Right. Yes, actually,
towards the end of his life, for example, Tagore himself tried to write children's rhymes. I'm not saying children's poetry, poetry for children, as he was the expert of doing. We know that Shishu Bolanath and innumerable other volumes. But the moment it comes to children's rhymes or nonsense rhymes, I think Tagore kind of pales into insignificance when you compare him with Sukumar Rai's accomplishments. So this is an incredible achievement on the part of Ray. Okay, because this is a different world altogether. Okay, this is a different ball game altogether. Not everybody can do that. So this is something we need to remember that it's not a matter of comparison. If Tagore is a genius in his own way, so is Sukumar Rai.
Yeah. And Shorab, as you said, this name nonsense is responsible
for some of it, isn't it? Because there's unfortunately a dismissive element in this word, nonsense.
So
perhaps we could think of changing it. This could be changed for the better.
We try and question the politics of the generic nomenclature called nonsense. How much nonsensical is really nonsense?
Exactly.
It's actually alternative sense.
That's the word, right?
It's alternative sense.
Not just a blind abandonment of sense, but you know, there's much more to that.
Absolutely. Yes. So it's a wonderful combination of nonsensicality and sensicality. Yes. So how can you kind of reduce it to a kind of pejorative generic nomenclature called nonsense? That itself is somewhat, I guess, responsible for the injustice done to the long tradition of nonsense literature, not only in this part of the world, but across the entire world.
Absolutely. Anyway, Dr. Srimanta Dash, do you have a question? We can see you on this. Okay. So then if there are no other questions, I have one with me here, which will be the last question for today. This is from Professor Shutapa Chaudhuri from Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharya College, Howrah. Satyajit Ray translated Amshatya Bhaja as framed chocolate in Bombagore Raja. What is your take on that? Satyajit Ray's translation of Amshatya Bhaja.
I guess this is called Lingon. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. It's a superb translation. That's it. That's my subjective interpretation right now. A translation, saying a translation good or bad, I don't think it's a matured way of, you know, doing research in translation studies. I completely agree with Professor Dashtakur, and I'm really thankful to Pritam Da. Because of him, I, you know, listened to Professor Dashtakur's paper, and an excellent paper, and the kind of theorization that he is talking about is there in his own paper. So it's a learning, you know, process for me. I'm really thankful to both of you.
Can I come in here a little bit on this last question?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Please.
Yes. So look, as they say, I'm probably kind of barging into Rindan's territories. Apologies, Rindan. But I guess, as translation theorists have repeatedly reminded us, all translations go through a process of loss. Not everything can be translated. Not everything is translatable. I would not go to the extreme of saying that, look, nonsense per se is untranslatable, nor would I subscribe to the idea that all quote-unquote non-nonsense literary works, that is serious literary works or adult literary works, are eminently translatable. We should not indulge in that kind of essentializations, reductionisms, or that kind of binary oppositions. The literature of nonsense is so complex, is so quotidian, so everyday. It's about our everyday life. Like Radhu Shimbaji talked about the body. I was talking about the world of images, world of visuals, world of auditory clippings. So much in abundance in great abundance in the late 19th, early 20th century world. So, and these nuances, these nooks and crannies of our mentalities, our mindsets, our cultures, our everyday practices, our habitus. So these are so much our own. These are so much personal, not in the sense of individually personal. This is culturally personal, ethnically personal. So this cannot possibly be kind of translated or carried at least satisfactorily in any other language, because language is not an inert medium. Language is a kind of wheel of its own. Language is a vital medium. It has a life of its own. It has its willpower. Okay, language refuses to carry certain burdens. It chooses to allow us to make it carry certain burdens. So it's not always in our hands that we can kind of make language supple enough. We can kind of domesticate it adequately enough to kind of make it carry the burden of our senses. So language always kind of beats our sensibility. We can make language do certain things. We cannot make language do certain other things. So in that sense, this Amshatya Bhaja is so much a part of the quotidian everyday Bengali ethnic life, and since this does not have any kind of equivalent in any other culture, forget the English culture, not even in many other Indian cultures. So obviously, the English language cannot have any equivalent that can bring the essence of Amshatya Bhaja quite satisfactorily. That is impossible. Likewise, English language has a life of its own. It has certain aspects which cannot be possibly satisfactorily captured in Bengali language. So we cannot dissociate language from life. The abilities and inabilities, the potentials and limitations of a language does not merely depend on the capability of the individual translator. It's not merely about myself and Sukanta Chaudhary and Satyajit Ray. Nobody can do this. Even though Satyajit Ray cannot possibly translate Amshatya Bhaja, which can satisfy a Bengali reader. That can give an approximation at best. Okay? An approximation at best, which can act as somewhat satisfactory, tentatively satisfactory to possibly an English reader who does not have any idea whatsoever what an actual, real, original Amshatya Bhaja is. That is impossible. So that is the limitation of language as a medium. That is precisely one reason why translation is inevitably always already a process of loss. You cannot capture everything. So that is my take on this.
Well, thank you, Shorab, for your comments. And if there are no other questions, then I must say that we have come to the end of today's webinar. I'll now request my colleague, Dr. Srimanto Das, to offer the vote of thanks to one and all. And from me, I just want to say to the two speakers today, Dr. Shorab Das Thakur and Sri Rindon Kundu, that today's webinar is not the end of it. I really hope to see both of you in person, physically, at our college in future when times will change. Dr. Srimanto Das.
Thank you, Pritamda. I was just going to say that, what you just said. So we've come to the end of today's webinar. Well, I really missed the lunch session of a regular seminar. And it's not just for the food. Actually, in a regular seminar, the organizers get to chat with the speakers during the lunch sessions only, I guess. And we, the organizers, really missed that opportunity. Hopefully, in better times, we will meet again in a regular seminar and compensate for the loss. Now, I guess it's time to thank all the stakeholders. First, I must thank both the speakers, Dr. Shorab Das Thakur, Associate Professor of English, Vishwabharati University, and Professor Rindon Kundu, Assistant Professor, Faculty of Arts, Communication and Indic Studies, Sri Sri University, Odisha, for their mesmerizing lectures on Sukumar Ray's poetry and his rather complex relationship with gender, nationhood, and Bengali modernity, and the rather difficult task of translating his works and transcreating his unmatchable humor. Then I guess I have to thank all the members of the Department of English, and especially Professor Pritam Bandyopadhyay, the HOD, for leading us from the front and coming up with the brilliant idea of organizing a webinar on Sukumar Ray. I must thank Dr. Pijaskanti Tripathi, officer in charge of Oldia Government College, for helping us in every possible way. We are also grateful to Professor Dipankar Sadhukan, the coordinator of IQSC, and the other members of IQSC for cooperating with us at every step. Special thanks are due to Professor Tonmoy Maiti and Dr. Debalina Das, and also the other members of the technical team for anchoring the ship through difficult waters. Well, the virtual world can only be, say, I guess, compared with, say, difficult waters. Last but not the least, I must thank the students and the other participants, without whose enthusiasm this webinar would not have been successful. Well, that's all from me, I guess, and now it's up to Pritamda and Debulina again.
So I guess I have to say what I must, that this is the end of today's webinar. And we are all now free to disconnect. Thank you. Thank you all.